This week's edition of Church Media Design TV is sponsored by Print Management Solutions. Welcome to another edition of Church Media Design TV, tips, tricks, and how-to for you, the church media designer. I'm your host, Brad Zimmerman, and I am joined every week by my favorite bobbleheaded friends. You got it right. We got Sean and Gus from Psych, one of the best shows on TV. We got Little Whitey, Colonel Sanders. I don't ever eat chicken, but I still like the Colonel. And of course, Jesus Christ, the Son of the Lord Most High. Well, in this week's edition, we're going to be talking about HTML5, we're talking about video on the web, we're talking about how to use all this stuff, what it is, kind of demystifying it with our friend John Dyer down in Texas, who I met at the Echo Conference, and he's going to help kind of demystify all of this stuff for us and help us to know what we can use today and what we maybe should stay away from. As well as I'm going to give you guys some cool Coca-Cola inspiration, because Coca-Cola always inspires me, as well as some free stuff and some awesome resources. So if my favorite bobbleheaded friends are ready, let's get into it. Well, today's little bit of news is kind of some old news, but it's from the Foundry. Now, the Foundry makes the plugin Keylight for After Effects, and they just released a brand new plugin that kind of changes the game a little bit. They released Camera Tracker. Now, Camera Tracker is what PFHO, we talked about PFHO when we did our 3D match moving tutorial. It allows you to extrapolate camera data from video footage so that you can put 3D information inside your scene. What makes Camera Tracker different is that it's a plugin and it's not a separate program. Up until now, all of these programs have been standalone programs. You'd go inside PFHO, you'd do your track, and then you'd bring that data inside After Effects. Well, this works right inside After Effects, and you do all of the tracking, everything inside After Effects, which is super cool. I haven't had a chance to play with it, but it looks like a really, really great deal. The thing that I really wanted to tell you about, though, is the interesting thing that the Foundry does. Now, the Foundry has a lot of different plugins, and they're quite expensive. So Camera Tracker, you can see here, is, you know, US, let's see, US dollar, it's going to cost you $250. So it's quite expensive, but they have this interesting feature on here that is rental. You can actually rent a plugin for a specified amount of time. So let's go back here so you can see rent, and we'll go in here and let's say that we want to rent this for, you know, maybe 7 days. We got a project, and the nice thing with this camera tracking is we probably, not positive, so don't quote me on it, but you should be able to, you know, extrapolate all the camera data you need and turn that into a regular After Effects camera, and then you don't need the plugin anymore. So you can do all of your tracking and just rent it, and we're looking at $15 for 7 days. So you could rent this for $2, I think it was $2 for 1 day, what was it? Yeah, $2.08 for a 1 day rental. And in that 1 day, you could track all of your shots and get them all ready to go, and then you don't need that plugin anymore. So I think it's a really cool idea that you could rent something, save yourself some money instead of buying it outright, $250 if you're only going to use it for that one series or for that one shot. So check out the Foundry and their new camera tracking plugin. Well, let's reach into the stockpile and grab some great resources for you and your church. And the first one is from filmmaker.com, and they have 22 filmmaking apps for iPad and iPhone. So for those of us out there with an iPhone or an iPad, these are everything from, you know, iMovie and RealDirector, which are editing programs on your iPhone to edit video, to movie slates like the DSLR slate and the movie slate, to, you know, storyboarding with the storyboard composer or a prompter. So there's so many different things in here. So these will come in handy out on the job, doing work in the field, shooting those videos. So check that out. The next one's actually a site I've been using a lot lately, and it's called Icon Finder. I've been working on a website and they don't have a ton of imagery. They need icons. So I've been using Icon Finder, and you can see they have tons of different icons. They have 184,000 icons and 616 sets. So let's go search for, you know, let's do the random icon of a person. We can see that they have all these different person icons. You can, you know, load up more per page. You can show it on grayscale or a checkerboard or on black to see what they look like. There's just tons of different ones. And let's say we like this guy, but we'd like to see what else is part of that set. And you can scroll down, you can see, oh, there's a bunch of different things from this set that kind of match it in the same style. And they're all free. So if you're looking for some neat icons, you know, social media icons, you're looking for a Facebook icon, let's just do a quick Facebook search. You can see there's a ton of Facebook icons, from bottle caps to the poke. Who needs the poke? To Facebook Places icon, that's brand new, so you can check all those out there. The last one is something that I get asked a lot when I'm at conferences, is where do you buy nonprofit versions of the Adobe software? So I just wanted to throw this one out there again. Many of you guys know this, but I've actually gone to a new website. I used to use Academic Superstore, but they're more for educational stuff. They've dropped some of their nonprofit help and all that kind of thing. Well, the one that Adobe recommends and I will recommend to you is CDW, CDW.com. And they actually have a Canadian site and a, I don't know where the G's for, but they have a Canada store. But they have a nonprofit store. Now, the interesting thing is you can't use their website to order any of the products. You have to do it by phone. You have to have all of your 501c3 stuff and all that stuff in order. But once you do, you can order it. And I think I paid right around $500 and I got the production premium plus a upgrade guarantee. And the upgrade guarantee is good for 18 months. Or 2 years, I can't remember, 2 years or 18 months, no, it's 2 years. So 2 years from the day that I buy my software, if a new version of that production suite comes out, I'll get it for free or for that money, which was around $200. The 18 month number in my head is the actual product cycle. Most of the Adobe suites come out about every 18 months. So you're pretty much guaranteed to get the next version. So I got CS5 right now, I'm gonna get CS6, all for that price tag. So for around $600, $100 an application, you're gonna get two versions of the Adobe suite. And they actually gave me a Windows and a Mac license. So I actually got two licenses out of that I can use. So pretty awesome deal. So check out CDW, you gotta call them on the phone. Check out Icon Finder, and of course, check out those 22 apps for your iPhone or your iPad for filmmakers. Well, we're here with John, and he's down in Dallas, Texas, right? Am I correct?
That's right.
Okay, so you're down in Dallas. I actually met him at the Echo Conference, and I thought I'd bring him on and have him help explain a little bit about the mystery that we all hear about with HTML5 and all the craziness with that, because we hear that it's this super wonder drug that can do everything we've ever wanted, but I don't think that's necessarily the case, and hopefully John can help demystify some of that. So John, thanks for being here today.
Sure, absolutely.
So John, can you kind of tell us a little bit about what is HTML5?
Okay, so that sort of depends on who you ask. So, technical definition of HTML5 is an extension of HTML, so it adds some new tags, you know, the little things that go between brackets, and then it adds some of the way that some of that stuff is structured. But the term HTML5 has been used to encompass also a bunch of new CSS stuff, as well as a bunch of new JavaScript stuff. So CSS, generally called CSS3, is a bunch of new things that, some of which are official and some of which are experimental, and then also a bunch of new JavaScript things. So some of them are the ways that you would write JavaScript, and then some of them are JavaScript tools, like being able to drag and drop files into the browser or being able to determine a person's location. So those three things, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, are all kind of broadly being referred to as HTML5. And just like any kind of word takes on meaning over time, and the ways that people use it become correct, I think that's sort of where HTML5 is going, is that it's being used kind of like Web 2.0, where it starts to encompass more than it originally meant. But technically, HTML5 is just new tags and a new way of writing those tags. But broadly, it refers to all these other things as well.
Yeah, and CSS, or JavaScript, just so everybody knows, JavaScript, and you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, my understanding is JavaScript can interact with CSS and change and do, basically can do animation. It can alter what's currently seen on the page and turn it into something differently. So it can hide tags, it can hide elements, change colors, all of that stuff. It can do it over time, it can rearrange elements, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, so all the text you see on a web page is generally HTML. All the colors you see and all the design is usually CSS. And then when you click something and it moves around, that's usually JavaScript that's doing the moving around stuff. Yeah.
So JavaScript is kind of that engine that works between CSS and works behind CSS to make it do new and interesting things.
Exactly, yeah.
I know that there's a bunch of different browsers out there that people are using, and I know that people online always hear about how everyone hates IE6, and for some reason that's Satan incarnate in web form. But there's a lot of people out there using Safari and Firefox. How does this apply to all of those browsers?
Okay, so there's a broad range of these. The first thing is that one of the features of HTML5 is a shortened doc type. So if you can show that in some way here, that'd be nice. But usually it says, you know, doc type, and then it has all this stuff after it. Well, the HTML5 doc type is just doc type and then the letters HTML. So just it's really short instead of being really, really long. And that's the first thing that you can do to make your website technically be using HTML5. Now, after that, there's a bunch of other things. Like, for example, normally when you would write a style tag, you'd also include a type along with it. But with HTML5, you don't have to do that.
Okay. Now,
all that stuff works everywhere. In any browser, even IE1, that stuff would work just fine. Okay. Now, when it comes to the new tags, some of them are things like header or video. Those things won't work in the IE versions. And the reason is that IE only accepts tags that it knows about. So if you want to use those new tags like header or aside or section or things like that, you need to tell IE about those new tags. And there's some tools like HTML5 shim that'll let you do that. Whereas all the other browsers, all the non-IE browsers, you can use whatever tag you want. Like you can make a Zimmerman tag if you wanted to. And they would be absolutely fine with that. But IE, you have to tell it that. And the only way you can tell it, though, is with JavaScript. And that's a little bit touchy, because if you want to have a site that doesn't require JavaScript, then you cannot use those tags.
Okay. So do all of the new, you know, the new HTML5 tags and all of the new CSS, does that apply to Firefox and Safari and Internet Explorer? Does that work in all of them?
So it really varies. First off, the technical HTML5 stuff, the stuff that's just tags, like header and section, those things don't actually do anything right now in browsers. They're just there for you to be able to kind of mark up your text and tell yourself kind of what it is.
It's an organization.
Yeah, no computer understands it right now, but the theory is that in the future it would. So you can use that stuff, but it's not going to mean anything at this point. Now, on the CSS side of things, it really depends. Some things work in a lot of browsers, some things don't. And Nathan and I, in our presentation, we tried to summarize the things that are going to work really well. Like, for example, CSS3 rounded corners will work in all browsers, including IE9. So that's one of those ones that I think is safe to start using, because it's something that will work long term. And for older browsers that don't support it, everything will be uniformly squared off. So it's a good idea. The box shadow is also going to be supported by all the browsers. However, text shadow, as an example, is something that IE9 doesn't seem like it's going to support. And so that's really unfortunate. You could probably use it, but you don't want to rely on it as a fundamental feature of your website.
Okay, so there's a lot of different, you know, variations, and I know that some of the way that you mark up all of those variations is different as well. Some of them you have to say WebKit this or Moz kit this and that sort of thing, right?
Yeah. So normally a CSS property like font-family works everywhere. But a lot of the browsers, when they're implementing something from CSS 3 that isn't fully standardized yet, they'll have a little prefix in front of it. So it'll say like -MOZ from Mozilla, which is Firefox, to say this is the way that Firefox is going to try out doing it for a while. And then -WebKit will be the way that WebKit or Safari and Chrome and the iPhones and iPads are going to try it for a little while. Now, once that's all become standardized and everybody's 100% agreed, then they'll drop those prefixes. And some of them, like for example, box shadow, I believe is one of the ones, or I'm sorry, text shadow is one of the ones that in browsers where it works, you don't need the prefix there. But it's probably always safe to go ahead and include, and you need to include the WebKit one, and then the Mozilla one, and then the Opera one, and the IE one. So you have to have a lot of stuff there to make it work.
Okay.
But it seems a little bit easier than maintaining images, though, and that's why a lot of developers and designers really like it.
Yeah, and it should be faster load times technically and some of that kind of stuff, because people aren't downloading these images to make it work there. And now it's selectable text and all of those kind of things. So it becomes a little bit more user-friendly.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Well, okay, so we talk a lot about video and imagery and that sort of thing here on CMD. And, you know, I personally am huge into the video world and know that there's a lot of weird things going on with H.264 and the whole copyright infringement debacle behind that, as well as the video tag inside HTML5. So do you want to talk a little bit about that tag and kind of some of that stuff?
Okay, yeah, so the idea of the video tag is that it should be just as easy to use as an image. So you can just write an open bracket and then video and then SRC for source equals your video, and it would just work. The browser would have the play button and all those things just like an image, and it would work everywhere. The problem was that unlike images where everybody could agree on using JPEGs or using GIF files or GIF files, they couldn't agree on a standard for video. And the reason for that is that all the videos are, the codecs are owned by different people.
Yep.
And so this created a big problem, because different browser vendors believed differently, almost religiously, about what was appropriate. And Apple really, really drove this, because they made all of their really, really popular iPhones and iPads support the H.264 standard, which pretty much anytime you're using an MP4 or an MOV, you're using H.264. Yep. Now, the problem with H.264, although it's great and it's fast and it looks really wonderful, and a lot of mobile phones support it natively, the problem with it was that it's encumbered by patents. And so Firefox believes, and so does Opera, that they should never, ever, ever implement things that have patents on them.
Well, and that actually brings up the point of that patent actually has been free to everyone, and that's why Apple and some of the others have said, well, let's just do it, because this company has said all of your HDTV that you're seeing on your TV right now is using H.264 compression, and they're giving that to all the broadcasters to use free until 20 some crazy number, and they keep pushing it back and keep pushing it back, but at any moment they can say, no, you need to pay for it. And it actually, just another side note, is that actually goes towards video cameras. If your camera records into a H.264 file, your camera can't be used for commercial usage. You can only shoot home videos to show at your house. If you would shoot a video for your church and show it on a screen, you would legally have to pay them to shoot that video on your camera, just as well as you'd have to pay them to show that online and all these other places. And I think that's why Mozilla is taking such a hard stance on it.
Yeah, and so, you know, regardless of what you agree or disagree on the issue, the problem is that if you want it to work, you have an issue. So you can do a couple of things. On the video tag, you can specify more than one source. So you can give an MP4 to all the Apple devices and to the computers that support that, including IE9, which supports MP4. And then you can give another file type, the kind of the second of the big three that we'll talk about. The second one is the OGG format, which is composed of a couple of different open source codecs, Theora for video and Vorbis for audio. And OGG is kind of like the container around those two things. So those are open source. And the problem with them, the good thing is that they're open source, so you don't have any of these rules. The problem is that they're not very good.
Yep.
For one. And second, the whole patent issue isn't entirely clear. So you might hear every once in a while someone saying that maybe if you really, really, if somebody really, really wanted to sue somebody, they could find a part of Veora that really wasn't open source, that maybe was borrowed from something else. And it's just not that great. It doesn't really work in very many places except for Firefox and Opera. So that's sort of a downside of it. It's a great idea, and the people behind it are wonderful. It just doesn't really work in practice as well. And then even if it did, you'd still have to have two files, which is just kind of annoying. So a third standard has come up in the recent I guess a couple of months actually, where Google bought out a video codec and then has open sourced it and tried to get it out into as many browsers as possible. And the codec for that's called VP8, and the container for that is called WebM. So you'll see WebM or VP8 around. And so far, all the major browser vendors have pledged support for it, except for all the Apple products. They have pledged to not support that at all.
Of course.
IE9 is kind of on the fence. They've said it'll probably work if you have the thing installed, but it won't work out of the box. So everybody upgrading to IE9, you're not 100% certain that it's going to work. In the future, the really, really good news is that Adobe has said that they'll put it into the next version of Flash, which means that you could use Flash to support browsers when they didn't have support for WebM. So yep. down the line, WebM may really be a great thing to work for computers, although it really probably won't be a good solution for mobile anytime soon. And the reason for that, sorry to get super technical one more time.
No, you're fine.
Is that the phones and stuff, they are just so underpowered, there's no way they can do video on their own. So they have a separate chip, completely separate from the rest of the computer, that's just designed to do H.264, and that's why they can do them so well.
And that's probably why Apple chose that codec, because they could get a separate chip that could do the decoding and they could have that fluid video playback. Steve Jobs is all about that end user experience, and so he wants to make sure that's the best possible. And so having that separate chip that can do it quickly, easily, and low power is a big deal to them.
Yeah, absolutely. So one way or another, you're probably going to have multiple files if you want to support everything all the time in all places. And so that's the reason why I kind of worked on a library that would allow you to just use one file and use one MP4 and kind of make it work in the cases where the browsers didn't support it for whatever reason.
Yeah, we actually talked about this just a couple weeks ago. I mentioned it in our stockpile of resources, and it's your media element JS, and it's a JavaScript library that does all that searching for you. You want to kind of just give a synopsis of like how it works?
Yeah, so one of the solutions for HTML5 video is to have multiple files that work, where a computer that doesn't support MP4 can then fall back to an AUG file, and then if it doesn't support the video tag at all, then you would put Flash inside of that. So you end up having about 30 lines of HTML to support the video tag, and it becomes pretty complex. You have to have lots of files and lots of things to support it, and it's neat. It's called videoforeverybody.net. And it will work without JavaScript, and it's a neat solution. But I wanted something that would work without having to have a lot of files and a lot of markup. So what MediaElementJS does is it looks and says, okay, what are the files that we have to work with? And then it tries to figure out what the browser can support. And then if the browser supports it natively, it'll use HTML5. And if it doesn't, it'll try to push in a plugin like Flash or even Silverlight, depending on what you have. Because a lot of people say that Silverlight actually, even though it's a Microsoft product, does a better job of displaying video on Macs. It's a lot smoother and doesn't crash as often as Flash. Now, the other reason why a lot of this stuff is important is that there are some fantastic libraries that do something similar to this. They use HTML5. And then they use CSS and HTML for the play buttons. But when you don't have HTML5, they put a completely separate Flash player in with a totally separate set of controls and play buttons and experiences. And so I really wanted that to be consistent across everything. So the way I made MediaElementJS was that it would be able to have one consistent set of players that would work across every browser and every possible situation. And it actually does a pretty decent job of it.
That's awesome. And so I got another question for you, and this is a curveball. So have you seen the new Universal Player from Vimeo that just came out in the last couple days?
Well, yeah.
My question about it is, why does this Universal Player use an iframe to do all of the work that it's doing, and why can't it work like YouTube, or, you know, well, YouTube's the only one that works on, you know, all devices and that sort of thing. I'm a little confused why it doesn't work like your Media Element library does, that it can figure it out without having to use this janky iframe.
Yeah, now I haven't seen, I think on Vimeo's site, I'm not sure that they actually use an iframe on their actual site, but when you do, in the old days of when YouTube started to do embeds where you could embed YouTube on your site, they would do that embed through a Flash object embed tag. But to do it right with HTML5, you really need to have the iframe so that depending on what the browser does or doesn't support, you can send different things into that iframe. And so that's the reason why they do it is that you can do a lot more detection and changes, because if you ever have to do something different, everything, I guess when someone's going to embed code from your site into theirs, everything they embed, that has to work forever. And so when you do an iframe, they can load whatever they want. They can keep changing that as the technology changes. That iframe can always just kind of be like a empty packaging, and they can stuff whatever they want into it. So if they got locked into using say one line of JavaScript in a video tag, and maybe that somehow didn't work in the future, then they'd really be locked in, and this gives them complete flexibility to be able to adapt and change over time.
Gotcha. That makes total sense. Well, John, I want to thank you so much for coming out and answering some of these questions about HTML5 and video and kind of how that all works. And where can people find out more about what you do and all of your stuff?
Well, let's see. I have MediaElementJS.com. We'll have that little application there. You can download it and play with it. It'll work for audio and video and MP3s and all that great stuff. I do occasionally write code-related stuff at JohnDyer.name, although I haven't been doing that a lot lately. And then my other interest is in kind of the theology and culture around our technology and the technology culture in which we now live. And there you can find out more about that at don'teatthefruit.com. And hopefully in the next couple of months I'll get my book in and we'll get that going. And we'll have a little book that'll be kind of a theology of technology and media. It'll be helpful for guys like you and me to have some, you know, theology going behind the stuff that we're doing.
Exactly, because it is, I mean, the tools are great, but if we don't have theology and the reason why we're doing all of this, if that isn't there, then the tools don't matter. You know, it doesn't matter. You know, it's got to be about the kingdom. It's got to be about using all of this stuff to increase God's kingdom, because it's what it's all about. So, John, I want to thank you so much for being here, and make sure to check him out there as well, as you can follow him on twitter.com/John Dyer, right?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So you can check him out there. So next up, we're going to get a little inspiration. Well, this week's inspiration comes from one of my favorite sources of inspiration. Well, that would be Coca-Cola. I've been a Coca-Cola collector for years. I get bottles from all over the world. My friends bring them back from their adventures. I have a friend who lives in Singapore, and he brings me all sorts of crazy Coke stuff every time he comes home, which I'm super grateful for. My wife, however, I don't know, she's trying to deal with it and try to figure out how to enjoy the Coke collection and not think it's this gaudy monstrosity, because I have a lot of Coke. Well, I follow the Coke Archives blog, and recently they've been talking about a 32-bottle commemorative set, and these are actually wrapped bottles that have all of the designs, so it's wrapped plastic on these bottles. And the coolest part about this is the design work goes across the entire series. So it's not, you know, like that Mountain Dew series where everything's random and it feels like a million different designers. This was one designer who did this design that flows all the way across this whole series. And so just check this out and say, how can I apply this to branding within my ministries? How can I apply this to a series graphic that gets branded across the board? I just think it's a great way to take this style and, you know, change it up a little bit, but it feels the same all the way through. So enjoy this Coca-Cola Mexican commemorative. How many adjectives can I put? But check it out.
Soy un hombre muy honrado que me gusta lo mejor. A mujeres no me falta ni el dinero ni el amor. Jineteando en mi caballo por la sierra yo me voy. Las estrellas y la luna ya me dicen dónde voy. Ay, 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 mi amor. Ay, mi morena de mi corazón. Me gusta tocar guitarra, me gusta cantar el sol. Mariachi me ha acompaña cuando canto mi canción. Me gusta tomar mis copas, aguardiente es lo mejor. También el tequila blanco con su sal le da sabor. Ay, 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 mi amor. Ay, mi morena de mi corazón.
Well, this week's freebie is a series graphic that I'm actually not sure if I've already given away or not. So if I gave this away a long time ago, well, I'm giving it away again. I know it's not listed on the website, so I wanted to give it away. It'll be listed in the freebie section at ChurchMediaDesign.tv, but this is Living Into Being, and this is a series that we did a long time ago, but I think it's a nice looking graphic that you can easily change out all the text, so I'll include what font was used and where you can download it, as well as the Photoshop file and high quality widescreen still and blank background that you can use if you don't want to change the text and you want to do a series called Living Into Being. So I don't even remember what we talked about because I think it was like 4 years ago when we did this series. So, but I wanted to give it away. I still think it holds up today. It's bright, cheery. It's got some good design principles to it. I don't know what I'm talking about. Anyway, head over to cmd.tv/livingintobeing. You can download it there. And yeah, check it out. Download it. Add it to your arsenal. Use it. Change it. Do whatever you want to it. Just don't redistribute it. That's all I ask. Send people to my site to download it. So anyway, check that out. Well, thanks for tuning in to another edition of Church Media Design TV. Hopefully you guys learned a little bit about HTML5 today. Hopefully you learned a few things about, you know, maybe renting plugins instead of buying them, and maybe got a little thirsty checking out the Coke inspiration. So don't do the real Coke, just drink the Coke. Hugs, not drugs, baby. Wow. Derailing here at the end of the show, but that's the way I like it. If you guys have any questions or comments, or you want to send in inspiration or resources for the stockpile or anything that you think you should see on the show or questions that you have, make sure you do that. You can send me an email, brad@churchmediadesign.tv. You can leave a comment on the episode page, cmd.tv/112, as well as you can follow me on Twitter, twitter.com/cmdtv, and you can send me stuff on there. Those are the best places to find me, as well as I'm going to start using it. I'm going to give it like a good month worth of use and see if it's worthwhile. The new dig.com launched, and you can find me on there, dig.com/cmdtv. It looks pretty promising, so I'm going to check it out for a little while. So if you're on Dig, you can find me there. So check all that stuff out. Download the freebie. But as for me and my favorite bobble-headed friends, we're saying see you later.